Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the architect of the annually acclaimed PhoCusWright Conference, its founder and chairman, that would be me, Mr. Philip Wolfe. Urosis persists, Kung Fu in Hainan, one small step, one giant leap. Pluto downgraded, Papua New Guinea landslide, Sandy, misery for millions. Remember Haiti? New words like Grexit, gamification, mass one-on-one, big data, non-stop opportunity. Encyclopedia Britannica and Newsweek end print. Twitter turns six. Diamond Jubilee and landmark handshake. Facebook, 1 billion users while refriending investors. Airlines take GDSs to court, 200 airline bankruptcies and counting. U.S. e-commerce reaches 8% of e-commerce. Royal Caribbean Commission sinks to 10%. Mobile check-ins for North American airlines pass 11%. Domino pizza customers worldwide by 16% via mobile. 30% of U.S. adults own a tablet or e-reader. 70% of mobile hotel bookings are last minute. Indian mobile web traffic overtakes desktop traffic. FCC cracks down on fake reviews. Apple wins near-field communications ticketing patent. Terror in Toulouse, the unthinkable in Seattle, in Aurora, Colorado. Remembered. Putin redux, Chavez redux, socialist enters Elysee, Google buys Frommers, Google goes Yahoo. Failed tablets pile up, Italian horror, Arab Spring turns to winter, the most decorated Olympian, what a dope. Baseball's triple crown, 9-11, 11 years later, Sendai, Japan remembered, stay hungry, stay foolish, lives on. Priceline to acquire Kayak, 4 more years. Patricia Rosore, PhoCusWright's own, may she rest in peace. Angelica, the 180 cabin luxury cruise ship anchored in a small, rarely visited Mexican fishing village. The sun-soaked seaside captivated the passengers as they dispersed from port like balls scattering after an opening break in the game of pool. While standing on a pier, an American businessman, reluctantly dragged on vacation by his wife, spotted a small bobbing boat with just one fisherman aboard. Spying several large yellowfin tuna, he complimented El Capitan on the quality of his fish and then asked, how long did it take you to catch them? Not very long, replied Juan Pablo del Generon, the proud fisherman. Then why don't you stay out longer and catch more, asked the American. Juan Pablo inhaled deeply. While exhaling through his black bristly mustache, he explained that a small catch is sufficient to meet his family's needs and feed an occasional neighbor. But what do you do with the rest of your time? The businessman continued. I like to sleep late, drink cafe, fish a little, play with my children, take a siesta con mi esposa Maria. In the evening, I stroll into my village to see mis amigos, watch chase games in the park, play guitar, sing songs. We dance sometimes, then come home to rock on my porch and tell stories. I have a very busy life. The businessman interrupted. I've been in business a long time, and I can help you become more profitable. To begin with, you should start earlier and fish most of the day. Imagine the money you will make selling the extra fish. With that money, you can buy a bigger boat that's better rigged, more fish, more cash, more equipment. You will run an entire fleet of trawlers one day. Juan Pablo stared at the visitor. He could see his reflection in the tourist-mirrored aviators. Then what would I do, he innocently inquired. Eventually you cut out the middleman, negotiate directly with processing plants and air transports, maybe even build your own facility. You would control product processing and distribution. And then what? One day you could leave this place for Mexico City or Los Angeles, maybe even New York City. Imagine that, managing your expanding enterprise from abroad. A flock of shorebirds landed nearby. Only the fishermen noticed. Having never contemplated such things, the Mexican fisherman then asked, "That's hard to imagine, senor. How long will all of this take?" After a rapid mental calculation, the businessman pronounced, 15, maybe 20 years. "And after that?" "Afterwards, that's the best part. At the right time, when your business gets really big, you will take it public and make millions." Juan Pablo del Generon was fourth generation living off the sea. He knew a lot about fishing, tides, nets, currents, and rigging. But he struggled with the unfamiliar while gulls screamed overhead and crafty pelicans dove after the chum he tossed overboard. "Really? What do I do with millions?" The businessman boasted, "You retire a rich man, of course." "And how does retire work?" "Well, you move to a quaint Mexican coastal village, live in a beautiful place, sleep late, fish a little, play with your grandchildren, take a siesta with your wife. You spend evenings drinking on your porch telling stories. You will have a very busy life." Although this parable has been told for decades to teach what really matters in life, I find the story's lesson about the need to pivot equally compelling. While the fishermen and businessmen chose dramatically different paths, they ultimately arrived at the same destination. Armis Clifford Mike Markula Jr. first met both Steves, Jobs and Wozniak, at their Palo Alto garage-turned-factory, busy building Apple IIs. That 1976 encounter produced the most famous angel investment in history, converting Apple from a partnership into an incorporated entity, a mere $80,000 U.S. equity plus a 170K note, made this engineer entrepreneur Apple employee number 3, and get this, a 1/3 owner. Wozniak credits Markula for Apple's successes more than himself. Markula helped the company obtain credit, raise venture capital, go public, beta test hardware and software, and champion the floppy disk too, all while providing adult supervision along the way. He became Apple's second CEO and then went on to serve as chairman during Apple's dark decade. In 1985, Markula took John Sculley's side, prompting Jobs' famous ouster. In 1993, Markula forced Sculley out. Jobs returned to Apple after a 12-year hiatus, during which time he founded Next Computer, reinvented animated film at Pixar, got married, raised a family, discovered his birth parents and sisters, and claimed paternity for his out-of-wedlock daughter. By 1997, Apple was in dire straits. Jobs obsessed about getting the magic back. He terminated thousands of employees and killed dozens of products. Ever impetuous, the Apple creator refused to wet nurse the board of directors, so he demanded a new one to start fresh. When the time came for Jobs to ask Markula to resign from Apple's board of directors, Jobs drove to his co-founder's mansion up in Woodside Hills to personally undertake the task. Markula promised his wife back in 1976 that he would only stay at Apple for 4 years, and he promised his wife to retire by 1984, So he surprised Steve Jobs by making that deed pleasant. The two Apple pioneers, 21 years after they first met, next discussed where the company should focus. Jobs asked Markela for the formula to create an enduring company. Lasting companies know how to reinvent themselves, Markela explained. You've got to reinvent the company to make new consumer products other than computers. 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 You've got to be like a butterfly and have a metamorphosis. And that, ladies and gentlemen, awakened a sleeping giant. It marked Apple's new beginning and the launch of an amazing pivot strategy. 3 months ago, Apple surpassed Microsoft, becoming the most valuable company in history. Each year, the PhoCusWright analyst team gathers virtually around the world to set one overarching powerful theme. Remember the hawk? Just like last year's raptor, the theme must be strategically correct, not politically correct. Past themes have included Travel 2.0 confronts the establishment, Braving the Long Tail, Chaos Calls, and Travel Unleashed. The theme for the PhoCusWright Conference 2012 is Pivot Point. Travel, tourism, and hospitality, the world's third largest industry at 9% of global GDP, has been jolted by dizzying advances in technology, voracious appetites for mobile and social, fundraising, M&A, and new threats. All along the industry's value chain, there is an increasingly urgent call for strategic realignment, because staying the course or tweaking are not sufficient. In other words, many of us are at pivot point. It is extremely difficult and rare to build a large, sustainable, profitable business, especially without pivoting. Few are lucky to get it right from start to finish. Look at Groupon and Zynga. Twitter, originally a podcasting business, became a micro-blogging sensation. YouTube was a video dating site. Flickr, a massive multiplayer online game. Pandora, a B2B recommendation service for music. Expedia's joint venture with Air Asia is groundbreaking, as was Priceline's shift years ago from U.S. opaque air to global retail hotel. Ask Steve Kaufer about TripAdvisor almost going under in 2001 with a B2B white label search engine business. He pivoted to a B2C banner ad model. When that failed, he pivoted again to a CPC model, and then with reviews, finally everything and everyone literally seemed to click. The call to pivot knows no boundaries. It applies equally to daring upstarts and media darlings, local players and global powerhouses, private businesses and public enterprises. In the context of this transformed marketplace, the pain of embarking on a critical course correction may pale in comparison to the cost of not pivoting.
Discover that our experiments have stopped being productive, let us pivot to a new fundamental strategy that could allow us to do better experiments. That's what a pivot is.
I was groping around for a way to describe a phenomenon that I kept seeing in the startups I was working with. So I wrote a blog post. I mean, the blog post, it wasn't like coining the term pivot. It just said, pivot, don't jump to a new vision. Now I'm good at encapsulating it crisply. A pivot is a change in strategy without a change in vision.
To pivot or not to pivot? That is the question. While we've taken some liberties with Shakespeare, the Bard of Avon himself elegantly explained knowing when to pivot. In Act 4, Scene 3 of the great playwrights Julius Caesar, Brutus proclaims,
"There is a tide in the affairs of men, which taken at the flood leads on to fortune. Omitted, all the voyage of their life is bound in shallows and in miseries. On such a full sea are we now afloat, and we must take the current when it serves, or lose our ventures.
I've been immersed in this space for a long time, 1989 to be exact. Does anyone remember the Independent Travel Technology Association I co-founded in 1991? We produced our first research report at PhoCusWright in 1999. You can see it. Lorraine was overviewing the almost $0 billion 1998 online travel marketplace. Early on, I was involved in two Expedia acquisitions, Travelscape and New Trade. Underlying these deals was the merchant model that took the industry by storm and catapulted the Microsoft spinoff to global dominance. Tensions, however, eventually mounted between hoteliers and Expedia. Hospitality players soon sought a new partner to replace this alleged predator. Enter Booking.com. Consumers and suppliers alike re-embraced the commission model. Parent company Priceline saw its stock soar. But we all know that OTA hotel relationships are never stable for long. Suppliers become addicted to the transactions, but allergic to their partner's clout. The latest golden boy has come of age, and now it's Booking.com's to start to be criticized. Prepare for a rash of pivots. Many travel companies know they need to pivot, but lack the fortitude to do so. Kodak, the Google of its day in the 1890s and until 1990, one of the world's five most recognized brands, demonstrated to our industry the perils of inaction. Kodak's decline is legendary. While longtime rival Fujifilm is doing rather well, both saw the writing on the wall, but only Fuji did what companies must do. Kodak's overconfidence in its brand and love for high margins delayed its inevitable move to lower margin new businesses. Whereas Kodak tried to take the easy way out but failed, Fujifilm rebooted, transforming itself into a solid business with a market cap today of $8.2 billion US, 152 times Kodak's paltry $54 million. What happened to Kodak's moment? RIM's most recent efforts to keep those loyal BlackBerry customers and app developers have elicited near universal criticism. But give these three RIM executives an A-plus for innovation in trying to overcome the skeptics.
We've all seen these are challenging times, baby, 'cause we're in transition.
Where's the pivot, I ask? Maybe Alex Saunders, Vice President of Developer Relations and lead vocal, should quit his day job. Many factors are stimulating pivots, from new payment platforms to everything mobile to a newer trend worth examining, big data. Big data is not a theory anymore. It is a given for success. Massive collections of data sets have historically been too large to use efficiently. But technological advances have recently made search, scour, capture, curate, store, visualize, and share imminently doable. And new entrants to our industry are doing just that. Two travel examples are Hopper and BoxEver. Full disclosure, I sit on the former's board of directors. The overwhelming similarity of general search patterns has long irked those who want to make travel search more intuitive and personalized. Despite the might of many significant players, experiential travel searching and shopping is still fragmented, frustrating, and by many accounts, broken. Legacy systems have hard constraints, making it difficult for travel companies to step away and rebuild from scratch. Meanwhile, most startups trying to reinvent travel discovery approach it from a social angle, which too often sounds better than it works. To fix the user experience, a structured catalog is required, which can only be accomplished through big data. Over the past few years, the world's major economies have been divided into two groups, the BRICS and the SICS. The US and EU led the latter with high unemployment, low growth, and whopping debt. By contrast, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and by some reckoning, South Africa were more dynamic. They represented the future and attracted businessmen, investors, and politicians in droves. The story of the BRICS has taken an unhappy turn. They are struggling. Some problems are shared, like weak Western economies and internal corruption, while others are localized. China, still the world's number two economy, is stumbling and creating a global ripple. Brazil has slowed below Japan's growth rate, and Japan hasn't grown in 20 years. India, home to the world's largest power outage, suffers clinical depression by many accounts, with political and economic reform paralyzed. Russia also has its troubles. Protests, current account deficits, a wobbly middle class, oil and gas money slowing. South Africa, host of the next BRIC meeting, is suffering a sad decline. We'll see. Although the BRICS will continue to grow faster than the six, those travel companies that pivoted to monopolize on a fairy tale version of the BRICS need a reality check. Back by popular demand, let's take a look at travel volume versus value. We welcome two new public companies, Kayak and an independent trip advisor. Congratulations, Steve and Steve. Expedia continues to lead the pack in gross bookings through the end of 2011, but that will narrow substantially by the end of this year. Despite predictions it would not recover quickly from its third quarter price plummet, Priceline has spectacularly rebounded. It retains an insurmountable lead in market cap at $31.4 billion US, more than Expedia, Amadeus, TUI, Concur, and Delta Airlines combined. China's Ctrip ranks third among OTAs at $2.9 billion, followed by Australia's WhatIf at a $1 billion market cap. Here's a look after adding other travel intermediaries beyond OTAs. Furthermore, including suppliers paints an even broader picture. Overall, Priceline, along with Carnival Cruise Lines, belying the ghost of Concordia, are by far leading the global travel and hospitality market cap scale, over 2.5 times the number three Marriott. And now, let's turn to the 800-pound gorilla in the room. Priceline acquiring Kayak just a few months after its long-awaited IPO. For starters, anyone here who says they saw that coming is a liar. Kudos to Jeff and Steve. Of course, Priceline strategized internally about what could possibly follow the incredible Booking.com ride. I had the pleasure to have breakfast this morning with Booking.com CEO Darren Hudson. I find his enthusiasm about the company's continued growth potential absolutely infectious. However, others believe that the business, in fact, is starting to mature, in which case, the right move is to face the next mandate, mobile and non-transaction revenue streams. So moving into search, lead generation, and advertising makes a lot of sense. Regardless of what you think about Kayak's market cap, Priceline's offer seems respectable at only a modest premium over Kayak's prior, albeit brief, high. By the way, this is one of only 12 deals done by U.S. public acquirers so far this year where stock has accounted for more than half the total consideration. The value of Kayak's mobile assets alone almost justifies the deal. I think this is future-proofing against the likes of TripAdvisor, Google's still anticipated moves with ITA software, and of course, declining marketing efficiencies. Even if you don't agree, the acquisition is a smart portfolio diversification. Metasearch is finally taking off, especially in Europe, because it now plays an important role in the travel ecosystem. Asia could be Meta's big growth hub next. In China, soon to go public, Chunar now gets more traffic than Ctrip. Kayak will thrive on Priceline support, especially with international growth and cross-promotion. Interestingly, securities analysts claimed it was difficult to analyze and value Expedia Inc. when it owned TripAdvisor, hence the spin-off to unlock shareholder wealth. Will they have similar difficulty this time around? Or will the Priceline Kayak structure be sufficiently different? Priceline's acquisition track record is stellar. With tons of smarts and tons of cash, this will be a fascinating deal to watch unfold. Maybe Kayak inside Priceline will be that elusive next growth monster.
You have brains in your head. You have feet in your shoes. You can steer yourself any direction you choose. You're on your own, and you know what you know. And you are the guy who will decide where to go.
The tectonic plates of politics and power are on the move while technology changes rapidly. New digital doodads become obsolete in just months. Our world, our businesses, and our lives are being rearranged in ways we don't fully understand. The past is becoming an increasingly poor predictor of the future. All of this explains why the need to pivot is on the rise. So on behalf of the entire PhoCusWright team, we cordially welcome you to yet another record event. Almost 1,400 of you from 30 different countries on 6 continents. Over 25% of you have traveled here from outside of the United States, including Brazil, Lebanon, Chile, Russia, Venezuela, India, Indonesia, Japan, and China. 55 of you are from the financial community, including buy and sell side analysts, bankers, M&A advisory, private equity, and venture capital. Unrivaled insight, healthy debate, critical corroboration, peer talkback, audience grilling, credible forecast, powerful thinking, and millions of dollars of deals. New York Yankee great Yogi Berra said, "If you don't know where you're going, you might wind up someplace else." But you, PhoCusWright conference attendees, know where you're going because you have decided to join the savviest group of executives focused on the strategic center of the world's third largest industry. May your pivots be sharp and your journeys fruitful. Oh, I almost forgot. One more thing. Can you feel it? Drum roll, please. The buzz is palpable. Ladies and gentlemen, let the show begin. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.